This is the Nordic Animism channel, and my name is Rune Jarne. I'm a historian of religion from the University of Uppsala in Copenhagen. And here's a little example of how to use the Runic Animist wall calendar that can be procured on the Nordic Animism homepage, together with its introductory book here. And I'm just going to go like walk through 1 month, which is the Yule month of this year, 2020, as an example of what it is you're looking at when you're looking at the Runic Animist wall calendar. The one behind me here on here is actually the 2021 version, which can be procured now. But the example that I'm going to use here to introduce you, the symbols that you are seeing when you're looking at the calendar is the 2020 version, the one that's relevant now, December this year here, the Yule month. Right. Here you see the traditional calendar signs that represents this month, your month, December 2020. If you had an old-fashioned calendar, then these symbols or similar ones would be carved in wood. And if you really want to, then you can still do that, of course. You can carve these symbols or similar ones on a rod, and then you have an old-school calendar, right? But what I've tried to do here is to merge this with our contemporary system and make it a little bit more available than little scratches on a stick, in order to sort of bring this, make it more available for contemporary people. Right. There are three lines of symbols that you see here. There are the primstavs that mark the holidays, the pre-Christian heathen holidays, and also more folkloric holidays that are found to be somehow important because perhaps they contain an animist potential of sorts. A lot of that stuff is described in the introductory book here. There are the weekday runes that represent the week year, and these seven repeated runes represents a weekday throughout the year. Each rune represents one weekday throughout the year. Then there is the bottom line of runes, which is the Tungul rhyme, or the moon rhyme, whose runes are golden numbers that represent the times where the new moon will land on a given year. It's a little bit funky to explain it, and I'll go a little bit down that road in this video here, but just accept that these runes represent the cycle of the moon in a given year. And the anchor point of this is the rune that marks the new moon, where the new moon will fall. And for 2020, that is the Hail rune. All right. Right. Let's start looking at the December this year. Tuesday, December 1st. Tuesday, as you will note, is marked by the K rune throughout 2020, except in the beginning of this year, because 2020 is a leap year. So before the leap day, which is 24 of Goa month February, the Sunday rune, which is sort of the anchor point of the weekday runes here, the or staff as it's called, these weekday rune, the weekday rune on the top, the Sunday rune was the R rune before the leap day. But the leap day falls outside the runic calendar. But it's still, of course, a weekday. So if one weekday falls out of these repetitions of seven runes in the runic calendar, of course, the weekday would be pushed a notch. So after the leap day, the R rune no longer marks a Sunday, but the Monday throughout the rest of 2020. And it becomes the Os rune that marks the Sunday for the rest of 2020. This, by the way, is what is marked in the template for the Orstaff cycle of Sunday runes, which is found in inside the Nordic Wheel of Seasons. When it is a leap year, then there are two Sunday runes, one before and one after the leap day. Right, but the basis is that the seven runes of the top line each mark a weekday in a given year. And now in 2020, we have the K rune, meaning that it's Tuesday. Cool. And this, of course, shifts from year to year. You'll have noticed that your birthday or Christmas Eve doesn't fall on the same weekday every year, right? It falls on the same date, but not the same weekday. So in 2021, this will be different. December 1st in 2021 falls on a Wednesday. But the runic code is the same. So in 2021, the K rune mark Wednesdays throughout the year. And this is how a traditional calendar stick works. You know the system, you look at it, and then you see a K rune, and then you know that this is a Tuesday for this year now, 2020. there are actually traditional calendar sticks that only have this or staff, this week counting, the line of weekday runes. And likely this week counting has an origin in traditional week year that has roots far back in the Middle Ages and the reckoning systems, where a year was counted by a set number of weeks, which was fixed in relation to the sun. Right, and calibrated, of course, in different ways that I won't go into here. Cool. The bottom line of runes are the moon runes. They represent a golden number. And what does that mean? Now, golden numbers are numbers between 1 and 19, and they're used on calendars to mark the place where a moon phase can fall over a 19-year cycle. Right? Because you've noticed that the phases of the moon fluctuate. It isn't, for instance, always full moon on Christmas Eve or new moon on the 1st of May. The cycle of the moon does not follow the dates in our normal calendar. However, this fluctuation of the moon isn't just random. It actually repeats itself in cycles of 19 years. If the new moon falls on this rune throughout the calendar on 1 year, then 19 years later, the new moon will again fall on that same rune throughout the calendar, right? And it is actually the new moon, which is the most important moon phase in order to keep track of this calendar. So this line of 19 runes, they all show a day that will mark the new moon at some point during this 19-year cycle. So for instance, when a specific moon phase is falling on the S rune here in 2020, then that moon phase will also come again 19 years later. The same moon phase will fall on the same rune again. You could say that this rune here represents one specific moon phase for any given year. And it will predict a different moon phase, perhaps. Some years, the S rune here will just predict a certain stage in the waning moon or something. But here in 2020, the S rune that we see on Tuesday, the 1st of December, actually predicts the full moon. And to make things a little bit more complicated, that is actually not visible here on December 1st. And the reason is that the astronomical full moon actually falls one day before, so that can be seen on November 30th. Runic calendar isn't 100% astronomically precise. Traditionally, the full moon wasn't a strict point in astronomical time calculation, but a three-day period. And the rune predicts the moon phase, not with absolute precision, but kind of, you know. Now, does all this mean something, or is it just a way of counting? And I've actually resisted talking too much about this, because when you talk about what this means, then you start to become associative with communication about the runes. And for reasons that I explained in another video, I actually don't really like that so much. The Havamal says that if you want to ask about runes, the best path is silence. So what I've done here is to try to supply the raw material from tradition, the naked data. The runes that mark the days throughout the year, and the old Swedish rune poem, which is attached to these runes. But I think of this as an open door. What does it mean that the S rune marks the full moon in 2020? I don't think it means nothing. And I don't think it meant nothing to the people who, back in the day, who developed and practiced this particular kind of traditional reckoning. This is a way of counting, yes, keeping track of time, yes, but we shouldn't predict our own idea that this is one thing counting, strictly insulated, for instance, from religious or magical meaning, on those people in the past who developed this system. Most other than modern people, they don't draw this distinction between secular practical usages and information and religious magical usages and information. These things are often, in most cultural settings, these are sides to the same thing. And this was people who took omens of everything they saw around them, saw the pattern of creation around them everywhere, and for whom the cycles of light certainly had a very high level of importance. You know, it can hardly be overstated, right? So the question I just posed here is actually formulated in the wrong way. Does all this mean something, or is it just a way of counting? It's not an either-or situation. These ways of counting are not distinct from meaning. They are also, in a sense, cycles of meaning. Right? So I'm just, with this material, presenting this material, I'm just suggesting this path, you know. You can start trying to understand it yourself. What does it mean that exactly these symbols represent the cycle of light in exactly this way in 2020, for instance? But, you know, please also try to respect this as traditional knowledge and keep it from this whole internet carnival of babble about runes. You know, this is real traditional runic cosmology. And if the Havamal has anything to say, then it's actually supposed to be engaged by keeping silent about it and letting the understanding of it brew and grow, you know. And this is also the reason that my communication about it is kind of consciously limited to the raw data, the naked material, making that available without going too much into details about it. Cool. Let's move on through the calendar a little bit. I promise I'll not take that long about it on every day. We find that the H rune mark Wednesdays, the F rune Thursdays, and so on. The Sunday rune of 2020 being Oz rune in the greater part of the year. And when we look at Wednesday, the 2nd of the Yule month here, we see that it has the Belthors rune in the moon runes, which marks the number 19. And that is one of these three strange ligature runes that form the last three runes of the calendar Futhark. The Orlöger gives number 17, and the Tvimadr gives number 18. And the root of these three strange runes is actually one of the topics that I haven't gone and investigated to the bottom. But they are a little bit enigmatic, actually. Why is it just this mirrored Thor's or Thor's rune that gives the number 19? You know, the numeric value of two Thor's runes don't make the number 19. So what is that? And these three runes are also given meaning in the Swedish rune poems. If this one here, the Belthors, if that marks a new moon in a given year, and thereby becomes sort of the main omen-giving rune of the Swedish rune poem for that year, then it heralds a difficult, dark year of hardship, but yielding a good crop. Well, that's what the rune poem suggests. And you can see this in the book here, where I've tried to make a translation available of the Swedish rune poem with these omens that have been attached to each rune. Right, so we move on through the calendar, and we are now in the waning phase of the moon. We have an N rune here, which is a calendar version of the normal N rune. The wax and wane of the moon are important, as you'll see in the introduction book. And in the 2020 calendar, we actually try to represent the waning and waxing phases of the moon with different shades on the staff here, but it didn't really work that well, and I doubt anybody ever really noticed these different nuances. So yes, we are also in the process of learning how to make as much of this traditional knowledge available in our contemporary representation as possible. So it becomes like immediately available for the user, right? We move on from the calendar and we now have a blank space. And why is that? Well, one cycle of the moon, from new moon growing to full moon waning and back to new moon, takes 29 and a half days. But in those 29 and a half days, there are only 19 spaces where the new moon can land, because the new moon, or any moon phase, returns to the same spots in a 19-year cycle, right? Did that make sense? And therefore, they're empty spots. Like on Friday the 4th of Yule month here, in the 19-year cycle of the moon, there isn't a time where the new moon will be predicted to fall on the 4th of the Yule month. But also remember that these runes, they only approximately mark the days where the new moon will fall. They're a cycle of runes, a cycle of meaning also, that sort of flows in the calendar. Right? Moving forward, we reach Saturday the 5th of the Yule month, and this is St. Nicholas night, meaning the night before St. Nicholas Day. But who cares about St. Nicholas? No. The cool thing is that this is Krampus night, the Krampusnacht, which is one of the most powerful traditions that is presently in the process of globalizing and spreading throughout the world from its point of origin in southern Germany and the Alpine areas. And I made another video about this. And of course, you can then find this symbol, the Primstaff, in the book, in the section about the Yule month, and read about it, right? It is here marked by a Norwegian traditional Primstaff. And with these traditional Primstaffs, there are always many different to choose from. And here I chose one that had a little bit of a diabolic feel to it, with these sort of horn-looking shapes here, and which I found to be fitting to probably the most metal holiday of the year, right? Cool, moving on through the days. Note that the same runes are marking the weekdays. Tuesday the 8th, again a K rune. And we move on, finding another Norwegian Primstaff here, which marks the Lusa night, St. Lucy, a really important night that was regarded as the winter solstice in the very old days. And you can read all about this in the introductory book, of course. By the way, the Yule month and the following midwinter month, or January, are definitely the ritual center of gravity of the Nordic animist year. When you look in the introduction book under the Yule month, you'll find that I basically have had to include little thematic sections under Yule month, like the wild hunt and so on, in order to basically be able to give a little bit of a feel of the massive ritual activity that used to take place during the Yule period. Cool. We move on here, and on Monday the 14th, we find the lunar rune of this year, the H rune, which defines 2020 and marks the approximate location of the new moon throughout the year. And you will notice that here on the 14th, the astronomical new moon fits neatly and actually also falls on the day of the new moon prediction of the runic calendar here for 2020 on the Hail rune. This H rune here is actually the most important rune of the year. The rune that predicts the new moon has a little omen with it for the year. And the old poem says, and you can find this in the book here, it says, Hagel er I bo best. Hagel regn hårdast. Tid vinder gott korn år. The English translation is also there in the book. And it tells us that this rune would suggest that 2020 would have a timely winter, but a good harvest. Now, in this calendar, I followed an established Scandinavian tradition of using the old traditional month names on contemporary months of our normal calendar. But the most ancient kind of months were actually lunar months. The word month is related to the word moon, and in that system, the new moon marks the opening of a lunar month. This Monday is actually a Yule month corresponding to December that begins here. So if you will follow lunar months, months corresponding from moon, from new moon, full moon, back to new moon, then this would be the first of the Yule month. And in the 2020 version of the calendar, I actually marked these lunar dates on the calendar stuff. So you can follow also lunar dates. And you can read about this also in the introductory book. But notice that this Yule month here, the lunar month, actually falls rather late on the 14th of our December. And that is because 2020 is one of those years that reckoning nerds probably love, while everybody else just go, ah! And that is, if you're working by Nordic lunar month, then a leap month has been inserted this year. Because in order for lunar months to stay in their place, stay in their season, you sometimes have to insert a leap month during summer. A whole extra lunar month, so the months don't fall earlier and earlier and earlier every year. And if we hadn't done this in 2020, then the Yule month as a lunar month would have ended on this new moon on Monday the 14th. So the month named Yule month would have come and gone 10 days before the Yule holiday. Right, and that is the reason that the Nordic calendar is a lunisolar calendar, like the Jewish calendar, by the way, and not just a lunar calendar, like the Muslim calendar, where, for instance, the month of the Ramadan falls earlier and earlier every year, and therefore, for instance, the celebration of Eid moves backwards every year, or forwards. but in North European tradition, the cycle of the sun makes a huge difference for people. If there's a month called frost month, you know, then it doesn't belong in June. So it has to stay in its place. Months in Northern Europe need to stay approximately in that place. And that, I think, is exactly the beauty, actually, of the lunisolar reckoning. You count by the moon, but it still also follows the cycle of the sun. And there's a kind of a rhythm to it. It is as if the moon months sort of breathe with the cycle of the sun. It's a very natural way of keeping track of time. Right. And in this calendar here, the lunisolar system is mainly represented in the runic calendar, which is a lunisolar system, whereas the main months are our normal months. But in the 2021 version, you can see the lunar dates and different lunar months. You can also see their names in the introduction book. Cool. We move through the calendar. Weekdays mark by the same rune, and it is now a waxing moon, a good time for a lot of stuff. You can read about this here. We reach Hulda's night. Again, you can read about it in the book. And here is the solstice, also marked by Norwegian prime stars. And it would make a lot of sense to work with the traditions of the Lucer night that I just mentioned here on the solstice, or around this time, because this is the darkest time of year. And remember how these different holidays show that it's not super dogmatic, actually. A solstice tradition needs to be around the time, but not necessarily exactly on the astronomically actual longest night. And here is the Yule, Christmas, which the English heathens call Mother's Night, after the venerable bead. And here it's marked by these drinking horns. These are Swedish calendar marks, actually, that express the celebration and ancient drinking tradition of the Yule days. A Swedish friend of mine actually described contemporary Swedish tradition that, to my ear, sounds like really Viking. they light candles to lead the dead home and drink Engla Öl, angel beer, basically a kind of offering of beer as a communion with the dead of sorts. Yep, and as we move on through the calendar, the week runes repeat themselves, the moon rhyme, the moon runes that represent the cycle of the moon, and we'll mark the new moon of a given year, and that's the way it works. Here again, on December 30th, we see the S rune, or the Sol rune, that marks the full moon throughout 2020, and we see that the astronomical moon phase does what it's supposed to and falls neatly on December 30th, as the rune calendar predicts. Cool. I hope this all made sense and it didn't just make the whole thing even more convoluted. As I mentioned, you can procure the 2021 version still in the Nordic Animism homepage with the introductory books that makes all this information available, and so you have the chance of going a little bit more in detail with it, or you can also just look at it and you know, use it to fall in with this rhythm of the year that is suggested by traditional animist reckoning. Cool. Thanks for listening, and see you around.